Welcome to Celebrating Act Two. Celebrating Act Two is the user manual for the second half of your life.
Welcome, everybody, back to Celebrating Act Two with our special guest, Manny Pacheco, and my favorite friend, Art Kirsch, the movie lover.
Hello, John. Hello, Manny.
Hello.
So Manny, you are a font of knowledge about everything forgotten about Hollywood. And I was thinking that Roger Corman was the king of B-movies. Tons of really great stuff. Gave a lot of people their start. But he wasn't the first. And I bet there is a load of people that were creating B-movies far before Roger. Do you know maybe one or two of them?
Well, before I mention one or two, let me explain to an audience what I might be saying to themselves. Well, what the heck is a B-movie? Because it is something that really is forgotten. Back in the day, our families were able to take us out, let's say in the 1940s, 50s, and even into the 1960s, for an afternoon at the movie theater. And that would include two movies, the main feature and then the B-movie. It would also include a newsreel and a cartoon. We could go to the movies on a Sunday, let's say at noon, and after two movies, that newsreel and that cartoon, we would not be leaving the movie theater until maybe 6 or 7 p.m. So it became an entire afternoon of fun, and it was a reason to look forward to Sunday after a day at church. So, a morning at church, actually. But, you know, the whole point of the matter is that exactly was the B-movie. It was the undercard in any kind of presentation. These were the movies that weren't as good, smaller budgets, and didn't have actors with the last names of Bogart or Hepburn or McMurray or even Gable or Tracy. So you would find some interesting actors, and they became famous in their own right. People like William Bendix. And here's a nugget for you. How about the queen of the B-movies, Lucille Ball? How about that?
Lucille Ball?
Yeah, she really would make more B-movies than just about any woman in Hollywood history. She became the queen of the B-movie. And that's one of the reasons why she turned to television, because she desperately wanted to be in those major movies, but she was confined to the B-movie. But I will tell you, there's an early entry back in 1939 that I would like to mention. Great movie, mostly in any other year, might have been considered a frontline movie. It consisted of an ensemble of stars. There was no real star to this movie, but it came out in that magic year of 1939, and it just could not compete with Gone with the Wind or Wuthering Heights or Mr. Smith Goes to Washington or The Wizard of Oz. It was a great little nugget called Five Came Back. It is the forerunner of the disaster film. It was a plane that crashes into the Amazon. And they were bold enough to tell you how the movie is going to end. Five came back. And if there's nine characters in the movie, you know that four of them are going to die. And it featured an ensemble that really, really excels. Joseph Kalia really does a remarkable job as the bad guy or the anarchist who emerges as the hero. John Carradine, Chester Morris, Patrick Knowles, Wendy Berry, and of course, as I mentioned before, Lucille Ball as a blonde. And it's just such a good movie. And it is the forerunner for movies like Airport and Earthquake and all of the disaster movies that would come 40 years later. Great B-movie. And, you know, I actually look forward to B-movies when I'm watching late night TV, let's say around 1 a.m. or 2 a.m. I think John is shaking his head. So I'm sure you have a B-movie that you turn to when you just can't sleep and you want to watch an old movie.
So a question for you, Manny. Of all the B-movies, because of the lower budgets and not known stars, have any of them actually become a contender or actually won an Academy Award?
You know, that's a remarkable question. You know, I don't know that they would naturally would win an Academy Award, but I'm sure some of them were probably, especially in the early years, because they just didn't quite have it together as to how to vote for the Academy Awards. So I could see some of the movies actually getting nominated. As far as winning goes, I know that small movies were nominated and won. Marty's a great example, but I'm not convinced that Marty was a B movie. I think that was a very celebrated television movie that became a pretty darn good movie of its own right, even though it was on a small budget.
Also, Manny, I think
if you were in the undercard, I just don't see that a movie would have been nominated for an Academy Award.
Yeah, I think that Marty came out pretty much at the end of the B movie era anyway.
Yeah, that's
but
true.
I wanted to follow up with Art's question. There must have been, because now in retrospect, we are watching these B movies and a lot of people don't recognize that they were made to be filler.
Right.
They were made to be undercard. They were made cheaper and with stars that were under contract and didn't cost a lot of money. But in retrospect, some of those movies have become very, very popular. They've become cult classics. And even though they might not have won Academy Awards, they have become more famous than some of the A movies that they played with. Can you
Absolutely.
Think of any of those kinds of movies?
Well, I can think of a relatively modern example, believe it or not, from the 1970s, a movie that just didn't quite come up to snuff and now is hailed and regarded as one of the all-time great comedies, Harold and Maude. That was a B movie. Nobody in their right mind was ever going to cast Ruth Gordon as a lead for any movie. She was a supporting actor, and before that, she was a writer of great comedies for Katharine Hepburn and Spencer Tracy. She was not a star of her own making. And then to put an unknown like Bud Cort, yes. I mean, this movie was just destined to fail, and it did. However, when it started returning to those art house theaters, like the New Art Theater in West LA, and it started showing on a weekly, if not, or monthly basis, and not a daily basis, it developed a cult following in the same way that, let's say, a Rocky Horror Show would develop a cult following. And guess what? Now it is revered as one of the all-time great comedies. Another small budget, I'm not sure it would be called a B movie, but it had a major star and it had some great character actors, but never really did well at the box office, barely broke even, was not considered all that important. Especially in light of what it was up against, is It's a Wonderful Life. It was never considered a really big movie.
Really?
It was kind of a comeback movie for James Stewart to get his feet back on the ground after he returned from the war.
Wow.
They were lucky enough to get a couple of nominations for an Academy Award, but the movie was never going to compete with The Best Years of Our Lives, which was really a high-powered A movie that also turned out to be an all-time classic. But in its own right, let's face it, It's a Wonderful Life is now an annual Yuletide classic. So,
yeah.
But as far as the smaller movies, I still go back to Five Came Back. If you really want to see one of the best movies of any genre, that's the movie. I will tell you this, though, John. Some of the great film noirs that wanted to replicate the success of The Postman Always Rings Twice or Double Indemnity or Asphalt Jungle, The Dark Corner, fabulous B movie, again featuring Lucille Ball. I mean, her name is going to pop up through these B movies like you would not believe. But a lot of these, the Strange Loves of Martha Ivers is a B movie, but they managed to capture Van Heflin and Barbara Stanwyck, although Barbara Stanwyck was ready to make the transition at that point to television. So I'm telling you, the film noir was a great area where you'd find some terrific B movies.
But you know, Manny, all these B movies with, let's say, Lucille Ball, which I watch from time to time in the afternoon if I, you know, just passing by and want to watch something light and fluffy, and Southern, whole
Southern,
series of those movies. They're fun. They're light. They're fluffy. All the Andy Rooney movies, which are certainly not B movies because they were stars, but they're all the same light and fluffy, whether they had stars or not.
You know, Andy Rooney was a major series, but it did spawn a lot of what you call B movie like movies. For example, the whole Henry Aldridge series of forgotten Andy Hardy like films. Nobody remembers Henry Aldridge anymore, but it was a real successful B movie series. And as a matter of fact, the whole Blondie and Dagwood was a B movie series, the whole Blondie thing. Also, the Bowery Boys, you know, the East Side Kids, you know, with Leo Gorcy and Hunts Hall, B movies that were very, very successful. I mean, the list just goes on and on with these series of films. Even which began as a B movie series, but then became very, very popular, the Dr. Kildare series with Lou Ayres and Lionel Barrymore.
Yeah.
So if you wanted to have great B movies that you could enjoy on a Saturday matinee, those the Flash Gordon series of movies were B movies.
Yeah. You know, Manny, you mentioned the Bowery Boys, and I recall as a kid watching a lot of these, what were technically then made to be the undercard, the B movie in an era when you would get two features and a newsreel and a cartoon. They all made the transition to television. They were cheap.
That's right.
As the theaters were moving away from a 5-hour show into a, you know, hour and a half to 2-hour movie, so they could play it continuously.
Right.
And sell more tickets. Television was rising up, and television needed stuff to put on the air.
B movies, perfect. Yeah.
Television bought a lot of those old movies, and I started my career directing shows that were what were technically wraparounds for the B movies.
And the first package that they bought was probably the Gene Autry series of movies.
Mm-hmm. Cowboys, old detectives, serials. Mm-hmm. Captain Winslow of the Navy, Flash exactly. Gordon, all of that stuff became fodder for early television.
Absolutely.
And then, of course, television developed and was able to actually produce their own, Walt Disney being a major part of that. But it made me think, as you mentioned, that we're really the B movies of yesteryear. Today, we don't know that they were B movies.
No, we don't.
They're and just old movies.
That's because of local programming like the Million Dollar Movie or the Fabulous 52 on CBS or KNXT. And they would show wonderful, even classic science fiction, the 4D Man, I Married a Monster from Outer Space, The Killer Shrews.
Yeah.
Nobody in anybody's circle of friends are going to say these were top notch films. The titles were campy, so there was just no chance that there was going to have a big budget. Even The Blob was a B movie if you think about it.
Sure.
Steve McQueen was not a star at the time, so the science fiction monster movies were also considered B movies. But you know, it made stars of some very interesting people. For example, special effects artist Ray Harryhausen was brought in to do some wonderful work,
like Jason and the Argonauts.
Yeah, the Jason and the Argonauts stuff. And you know what? B movies have their place, and they have their stars, and they have their fans. And I think that's where I should leave it.
Okay. Yeah. Today, the movies that are made a little cheaper and maybe without stars that you'd recognize, we call them independent films.
Yes. And they always run around March or April as opposed to September or October.
But one thing is for sure. As an expert on B movies, you are definitely A-list. You're definitely a star billing about whether it be B movies or beyond. Anyway, thank you, Manny, again for an amazing, wonderful session. You actually do have a voice made for radio, because you are on the radio as well. So it's wonderful to listen to you and have you retell, actually just pull out of your well all these wonderful memories of things that are forgotten by everybody about Hollywood. So thank you.
Well, I'm pulling it out of from somewhere. I just don't know the world.
Yeah, we don't want to go
too much,
there.
Too much information.
But I'll tell you, everybody, you've got to go to Manny's website, which is www.forgottenhollywood.com.
Or?
And read his blogs. Mm-hmm. And
if you want to binge
buy his books.
Or if you want to binge watch his series, go to YouTube channel of Celebrating Act 2. While you're there, you can subscribe as well. But there's a playlist of Manny's interviews with us and conversations with us. And you could just spend an entire day now watching Manny over and over and over again and getting all this great stuff that is forgotten to Hollywood and most of the rest of the world. So thank you for helping us remember. So I think with that, we should exit stage left rather quickly. See ya.
Say goodbye, Manny.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
For more on Celebrating Act Two, visit our webpage, follow us on Facebook, subscribe to us on YouTube, and tell your friends. Celebrating Act Two is the user manual for the second half of your life.